I was glad when they said to me, let us go up to the house of the Lord. And now we are here, standing in the gates of God's holy presence. Welcome to Christ United Church of Christ for our worship service today. We have a wonderful worship service planned for you, and I know you will be blessed. So let's get to worship right now.
Good morning, and welcome to Christ Church. I'm Matthew Heller, your liturgist this morning. Thank you for joining our worship service today. No matter who you are, no matter where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. Please join in our call to worship this morning. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. The Lord will not always accuse, nor will the Lord harbor anger forever. The Lord does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is the Lord for those who fear. As far as the east is from the west, so far has the Lord removed our transgressions from us. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, you are the only source of health and healing. In you there is calm and the only true peace in the universe. Grant to each one of us, your children, an awareness of your presence and give us the perfect confidence in you. In all pain and weariness and anxiety, teach us to yield ourselves to your never-failing care, knowing that your love and power surround us, trusting in your wisdom and providence to give us health and strength and peace when your time is best. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Lift your voices in praise to God with our opening hymn, Love Divine, all loves exceeding. Number 517 in our hymnal, and words are on your screen.
Good morning again. It's time for us to turn to God's Word. Our reading this morning is about forgiveness. And Jesus tells a story about someone who was forgiven a lot, but who found it impossible to forgive others. Thanks to Matthew Heller for reading our scripture this morning.
Our scripture reading is from Matthew, chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Once Peter asked Jesus, "Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Should I forgive as many as seven times?" Jesus said, "Not just seven times, but rather as many as 77 times." God's dream for us is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle accounts, they brought him to a servant who owed millions of dollars. Because the servant didn't have enough to pay it back, the master ordered that he should be sold, along with his wife and children and everything he had, and that the proceeds should be used for payment. But the servant fell down, kneeled before him, and said, "Please be patient with me, and I'll pay you back." The master had compassion on that servant, released him, and forgave the loan. When that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him just a few dollars. He grabbed him around the throat and said, "Pay me back what you owe me." Then his fellow servant fell down and begged him, "Please be patient with me, and I'll pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he threw him into prison until he paid back his debt. When his fellow servants saw what happened, they were deeply offended. They came and told their master all that had happened. His master called the first servant and said, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you appealed to me. Shouldn't you also have mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you?" His master was furious and handed him over to the guard responsible for punishing prisoners until he had paid the whole debt. Our heavenly Creator will also do the same to you if you don't forgive your brother or sister from your heart.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to be with you again. And we've come to the time when this is the message for our children. So gather them around, but it's also a message for our very young at heart. So that includes all of you. And as we know, it is time to go back to school. It's back to school time. And one of my favorite things about back to school time is school supplies. If you don't know, I love school supplies. And when I was a little girl, one of my favorite things to buy were new pens and pencils. And I have not outgrown that. I still love new pens and pencils. So I brought a few with me today because they've kind of been making me think of something. This pen has lots of colors, if you can see it. This is my favorite pen. Any pen that has lots of colors is my favorite. And the other day I was writing with this pen and I made a mistake and I had to just cross it out, or I could scribble over it. And it made the mistake sort of go away, but I could still see that I had scribbled it out. It was still a reminder to me that I had made that mistake. And I started thinking about how sometimes we do that with people and with ourselves. If we make a mistake or if other people make a mistake, we try to forget about it, but sometimes, like the scribble on the paper, we still remember it and we don't just let it go away. But if I'm writing with this pencil and I make a mistake, I can take that eraser at the end and I can erase it and it goes away completely. And I can forget about it and I can write right over the top where I made the mistake and I can just keep going forward on whatever kind of work or note I'm writing. And this pencil reminded me that that is how God works when we make mistakes. You know, we make a mistake and we go, oops, made a mistake. And that's kind of when we say our prayers and we pray to God and we ask for forgiveness for a mistake we made. God says, okay, and sort of erases it away, and we get to move on. And God doesn't leave little pieces of ink laying around that remind us that we made a mistake. God's like this pencil and the eraser. And when we make that mistake, God allows us to erase it and to try again and to do better. And that's how God wants us to be, with ourselves and with one another. We're all going to make mistakes. It's how we learn. It's how we grow. But when we do, we need to erase that mistake, to try again, and to move forward, and to not keep reminding ourselves that we goofed. Will you pray with me? Loving God, we give you thanks for forgiveness, for allowing us to try again, for blessing our lives with the ability to pray to you and to ask for forgiveness. We pray that you will help us to be your loving heart and to forgive one another. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Ready? Holy, holy. Thank you.
day, I was in the drive-thru getting some coffee. Many of you know that I love my coffee. So I was in line and placed my order, and as I got up to the window to pay, the lady working said to me, "Your order's already been paid for. The gentleman in the car in front of you paid for your order." Now that was a nice surprise. Maybe that's happened to you. Maybe you've done that for somebody else. But that man in that car didn't know me. He had nothing to judge about me. He didn't know if I was a good person or a bad person. He didn't know if I had had a great day or a bad day. He showed me unconditional kindness with no strings attached. Now, the thing for me to do is to return that favor to someone else when they least expect it. And that's what our scripture reading today from Matthew is teaching us about forgiveness and about moving forward. To forgive, and to forgive someone else when others have given you that forgiveness. Most importantly, when God has given forgiveness to you. In the reading, Peter asked Jesus, "How many times should I forgive my brother?" And he says 7 times, and Jesus says no, and he gives Peter a way bigger number than what Peter expected. And then Jesus tells Peter the story of the unmerciful servant. And what I find so interesting about this story is that it shows a great example of how people have the same opportunities to forgive, but often handle them so differently. Even in our own lives, we handle our own opportunities to forgive very differently, and differently at different times. So let's look at the similarities in this story. First, we have the king or the master and his servant. Now, they both had servants that owed them something. They both threatened horrible ways to repay the debt. The king was going to sell his servant and family and their belongings to repay their debt. And that servant was going to throw his servant into prison to repay his debt. But both had the chance to forgive. Now let's look at the similarities between the two servants. They both had debt. They're both being told to repay this debt. They both fell to their knees when they were asked to repay their debt. Sort of seems like they're at their wit's end, or they're struggling with how to pay that. And they both said, "Be patient with me. I'll pay you back. Be patient with me." They both knew what it felt like to have something hanging over their head, something they didn't like particularly. But there's also a lot of differences in this story between these same people. See, the first servant was given forgiveness for his debt. A king forgave him. His master forgave him. And not only was he granted forgiveness, but he was now given the chance to be like his master, to do the same for his servant. The master of that servant was living out what Matthew chapter 7, verse 12 states, "So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you." He was actually being a great example of God's love towards his servant. But when that first servant was given the chance to forgive his servant for his debt, he decided not to follow in those same footsteps. He not only didn't forgive his servant's debt, but he threw him in prison, a decision that didn't play out very well for him in the long run. Now, often in our own lives, we become each one of these characters in this story that Jesus is telling us. Sometimes we forgive, Sometimes we are the forgiven, and sometimes we forget to forgive. And while we may not throw someone in prison, we carry a grudge or never really forgive and forget and move forward. We may forgive, but we often make that person, often even ourselves, pay for those mistakes. Now I want to read you another scripture lesson, and this is in the book of Genesis, and this is the story of Joseph and his brothers. This is following the death of their father Jacob. And this is Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 through 21. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?" So they sent word to Joseph saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Now I ask you, how would you feel about someone if they threw you into a pit, if they then sold you into slavery, and then they told your father that you had been killed by wild animals and even took your coat to show as proof, when clearly you were still alive? That's what Joseph's brothers had done to him. See, Joseph and his brothers, they didn't have the best relationship. They had that sibling rivalry. But now that their father, Jacob, is dead, the brothers start to get a little nervous. At this point, you see, Joseph, he's a pretty powerful man. And he could easily have paid his brothers back. During that time, it was something that could be done. So the brothers send a note to Joseph stating what their father wants him to do. And they start out with "your father," which I think is a little interesting. Not "our father," but "your father." It's still showing some separation and between the brothers and between Joseph. Now, we don't really know that Jacob left this note. It's more likely that the brothers themselves are writing it. And they tell Joseph to forgive. They tell him to do this through the note. They don't just go to him and ask for forgiveness. It seems that they maybe don't feel worthy of forgiveness. They're asking out of fear. You know, it isn't any easier today for us often to say, "I'm sorry, and will you forgive me?" But Joseph had clearly already handed his hurt and his anger over to God. He had, in fact, already forgiven his brothers. And he says to them, "I will provide for you and your children." So how do you forgive someone who hurts you? How did Joseph forgive his brothers for the terrible things that they did to him? Maybe the real question, the question we want to ask but are afraid to ask, is why should we forgive? But here's the answer. Because God forgives you. Through forgiveness, you will be given peace peace of God. Now, when you forgive, it doesn't mean that you're saying that what someone did or what you did is okay. But it does say that you too make mistakes. It says you're choosing to live a godly life instead of a life of anger and bitterness, that you are handing your hurt over to God through your forgiveness. You're giving someone else the space and the chance to do better, just as God does for you. Now, I've been standing this morning by the baptismal font as a reminder of God's forgiveness that we receive through our baptism, the reminder of God's promise to forgive us and to cleanse us of our sins. When someone forgives you, or when you forgive others, it feels good. Sort of fills you with new life. See, in these waters of baptism, that is what God is giving you. New life and forgiveness. New life and forgiveness. In both of our scripture readings, the servant in the first reading and the brothers in the second reading, they were surprised by what they were granted. Have you ever been surprised by what God forgives you? Sometimes it's easy to just mess up and say a prayer asking for forgiveness and then just move on and maybe making the same mistake again. Sometimes we repeat that pattern over and over and over, and yet every time that you do that, God is there for you, forgiving you. But often for one another, even for ourselves, we make that a little more difficult. We aren't so quick to forgive, and certainly not to forget. The master in the story that Jesus tells and Joseph, they both had forgiveness in their souls, much like God. Now, I encourage you, whenever there is water in your day, perhaps you're watering your flowers or taking a shower, maybe you get caught out in the rain, or pour yourself a glass of water. As the water cleanses you or quenches your thirst, or as you are giving nourishment to God's creation, take a few moments and remember the new life and the forgiveness that God has given to you. And I want to close with a quote that I do not know the author. I've only ever seen it anonymously. But I encourage you to think of God as I read this. I never knew how strong I was until I had to forgive someone who wasn't sorry and accept an apology I never received. Amen. And our hymn response today will be "Just As I Am, Without One Plea." let us be in the spirit of prayer. God of mystery and wonder, you are the heart of all that we are and all that we do. In these quiet moments, hear the concerns of our hearts as we lift our prayers to you. We pray to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear our prayer. Amazing and loving God, your compassion and grace are the wellsprings of life. We gather this morning to sing your praise and to tell of your magnificent ways. We begin this day delighted to be called children of God, telling your message with thanksgiving in our hearts. We pray to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear our prayer. Creator God, you set before us a world full of beauty and wonder, stillness and peace. Often we are selfish and let the busyness of life distract us from your brilliance. Awaken in us a spirit to hear the singing of the birds, to embrace the warmth of the sun, to live each day in awe of your masterpiece. Direct our hands as we tend to your precious creation and protect it from harm. We pray to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear our prayer. Holy God, through Jesus, you embody perfect compassion and love. Wrap the warmth of your spirit around those who are ill. Lend your strength to those who are weak. Make yourself known to those who are lost. Your world needs your guidance. Guide all people to be with you. We pray to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty God, foundation of our faith and sustainer of life, we lift all of these prayers to you in the name of Jesus, whose mercy and grace is with us always. Amen.
In response to God's still speaking word, we affirm our faith with the words of Paul from Ephesians chapter 4. There is one hope, one calling to which we are called. The hope in our lives is Jesus. The call we must answer is God's. There is one faith, one hope, one Lord of us all.
The Lord of our lives is Jesus.
There is one baptism, one Father, one Mother of all.
The Creator who calls us is God.
We are one body, one family, one church, woven by the Spirit with the bonds of peace. With Christ's children throughout all of this earth, we are one body in unity and love. Amen.
As our service comes to an end, remember that it is now that we go out into God's world to do God's work. It is now that our duties as children of God are to be carried out. The things that God calls us to do and the people that God calls us to be will never end. God's forgiveness is a gift. God is calling you to share that gift with one another. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you and give you peace. Amen.